Hi, my name is Holly Young, and I am the owner and designer of Making Mathematicians. I myself am a mathematician and a math specialist and math trainer that's been working with San Antonio Independent School District. We made this video as a quick introduction for administrators that are wondering what math training is happening right now for elementary school teachers. And this is the introduction. So you can see a chart on the screen that shows how we're running a video-supported PLC guide for teachers. Our implementation specialists were mentioning that it was very difficult to get to every single school and to provide the math training that our teachers need. So we decided to make a video support so that teachers could watch it on their own time, discuss with colleagues, and then come back together and have some really great lesson planning time in the PLCs. So the way that the video support works is it starts with a part one to the video, and the part one of that video is really a chance for the teachers to get some mathematics background for their video. So in that part one, we do some background understanding. So where does this math come from? What is the theory behind it? And any kind of vertical mapping. In other words, where does it go? What does it lead to? Why is it so critical? The second thing that we include, that I include in the videos, is how students build and need to build cognitive understanding of that mathematics. So in that cognitive understanding, what we need to understand about children is that any type of learning goes from concrete to pictorial to abstract. So in other words, if you think about an early learner, like a kindergartner, for instance, they need to start when they learn the concept of number with actually counting objects, things they can hold, three keys. They touch three cups, three of anything, and they get the concept of three. And then we start working at pictorial. So we have pictures of three teddy bears and three cups, and there's pictures, and we circle three items that builds that pictorial understanding. They're not touching the object, but they're seeing that frequency of three together. And then eventually you move to the actual physical number three, and that's the abstract. So when students see that number three in their head, they can picture three of any item. That same type of learning occurs for any person when they learn any type of mathematics. It just turns out as the older you get, especially past the age of 15 and 16, you can move fairly quickly to the abstract level. And even some of our younger children can move quickly. But what I do for teachers is I try to explain to them what is the concrete style of learning, what's the pictorial, and what's the abstract. So, for instance, in fourth grade in the particular measurement unit, some of the things that I'll be helping, and there's a whole video, and you're welcome to watch any of them. If you talk to the implementation specialist, they can hook you up with them. But looking at rulers, that students have to measure any kind of objects with rulers, they need to measure objects that don't start at zero, they need to measure objects with broken rulers so they get a really sound foundation of measurement. So, it's concepts like that, and I go slowly with it with the teachers so they can really understand what the standard is getting at, and cognitively what students need to do to truly understand what that mathematical standard is talking about. So part two of the video for teachers is they watch the math part and they take a note maker, and then they get together and talk about the mathematics. The second part of the video then gets them into the actual planning of lessons. So part one of that planning, which we call video part two, asks the teachers to unpack the teaks. And what's really nice about it is that I have a tutorial for them so that they can go and watch specifically how to unpack a teak and where that information comes from, so that they would be able to really understand the standard that they're about to teach. They've watched some math concepts of it, but now they need to get into what the standard actually says. And what I do for that is I break it up into factual, procedural, conceptual knowledge, and generalizations, teaching teachers what that means, how to look for those pieces within the TEKS resource system, so where they are located, and how you have to parse that information out and become really knowledgeable about what type of knowledge you want from the students. But there's a big unpacking that goes on, and so that the teachers really use their resource system and understand the TEK when they go to teach this material, not only the mathematics behind it. So part three of the planning then, after you've unpacked the teak, is to take that unpacked teak and create essential questions. They can be objectives as well, but what we want teachers to do is create really rigorous and engaging essential questions. So there is a tutorial on how to do that from something that's been unpacked. It helps teachers move things up the Bloom's wheel, so we really get at the rigor we're looking for in the mathematics. So what you might see is at the top of the screen, there's an unpacked teak. And each of those unpacked teaks become a really great question. And it's an engaging question that's going to push students for some higher levels of understanding. If you notice that factual information doesn't always make essential questions, and for the most part, that's not where we want the students to sit. That's when they usually are too low in mathematics. So it's something that I end up teaching the teachers on how to make those essential questions highly rigorous. And then also is moving them up the Bloom's level. Can you take a particular essential question and make it a little bit higher level on the Bloom's arrow? Now, the teachers have a Bloom's arrow that they can use that has all kinds of verbs to help them, and it's in the tutorial on how to do that and how to make sure that your questions aren't at the recall level, because that's not the level of understanding we're looking for in mathematics. The next phase of the video has teachers create their assessment. So we're really following that backwards lesson design format, which is you pick your goals, and the second piece, you need evidence of understanding. So that next video part is to have the teachers create their full summative, and they can use the TEKS resources system to do that. And their formative assessments. There is a tutorial on how to do really effective summative and formative assessments that the teachers can watch. So when we do that, we actually show them where in the TEKS resource system they can look. They can also meet with implementation specialists if they need to look ahead, but they should create their summative before they teach the unit. And then we talk about the formative pieces, including especially pre-assessments if students have already mastered material. And then I show them in the TEKS resources where to find some of that under the misconceptions, underdeveloped concepts, and I give them specific clues on what type of assessments work well in particular areas of math. So thinking of assessments a little bit deeply to make sure that we intervene with students before they go too far in their learning. So in this case, for instance, I've given an exit ticket of how you can use an exit ticket and have students rate their own learning. I've even done manipulatives that students can use to show understanding. So then next part, after you have your evidence of learning, we ask the teachers to then create their lessons, to go through and create an actual scope and sequence to figure out what they're going to teach, in what order they're going to teach it, what activities they're going to have, what resources they need. And there is a tutorial for that as well. So to help teachers who haven't done their own lesson planning or laid it out using this backwards lesson design, starting at the essential questions, moving through the assessments, and then creating the lessons. So there is a tutorial for that as well. When we plan these learning experiences, we actually have the teachers think about their scope and sequence, but we push it toward the essential questions. So how are you going to teach these essential questions? Is it going to take 2 days, 3 days? What formative assessment are you going to use? What action will you take off of that formative assessment? What are the learning tasks? What resources do you need? And then from that, we build into what language objective is going to be the focus of the day: reading, writing, speaking, listening, and then what social objective. And a lot of our social objectives not only have to do with interacting with one another, but also using our math process standards. So teachers go ahead and fill all of that out on their own, working with their colleagues when they're planning, and so that they've built an entire learning experience from start to finish. And then schools do get to submit those lesson plans to the ISs, and along with timesheets of working beyond the school day and PLC day for some compensation. And what we're hoping to do is build a pretty big library of materials, and that for teachers to get together from different schools and look at their lesson plans for a unit and be able to share some of their best work, and put all that collective genius together. But that's basically how we are doing our video supported units for all of math. We're going to be start, this is already started in fourth grade, and we're working to having it in as many grades as we can in the elementary schools. And our ISs are going through a full training for teachers that are available. So they are taking them through this whole process, viewing the tutorials, making sure they have a full understanding as they go back to plan on their own. Thank you.